how do you like our place? Today we are celebrating the start of Older Americans Month because we're going back to a later time, probably before most of you were around or maybe in the conception stage, possibly. But anyway, we are going back to 1920s. And with Older Americans Month, we have our theater group, a group of older Americans performing for us today. So we're glad you found the password, but first, if you've got a cocktail left, let's raise that glass to the end of Prohibition. Yes! Happy
crowd here, I like it.
Prohibition in the 1920s Chicago, and there's a mob war brewing between the South Side gangsters and the North Side mob outfit. No surprise, is it? Well, two ruthless leaders, but now I'm going to introduce the staff. They're going to come in our cast, and then let's get them all, let them all roll in here.
Oh my God. That's great.
So does it look like we're ready for the 1920s mobs?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Well, as I said, there's a mob war brewing, and we have two ruthless crime leaders. We have Hal Capone over here. Medio Dandon over here. They reached an agreement, believe it or not, on some bootlegging practices in Chicago, and have decided to pull together resources to undergo a collaborative effort, so they say. But we'll see about that and all their other criminal endeavors. But recently, the gangsters from the North and the South Side have been spotted together in speakeasies across Chicago, just like here, the Grand Gatsby. But the tension is in the air, always thick. You can cut it with a knife. However, the newfound relationship between the ongoing mob bosses has served thus far to inhibit gratuitous bloodshed as in the past. No surprise there either. Part of the success of this truce is that both crime bosses have found new dames, thereby intertwining their mutual relationships. The two gangs have set an official date to meet here, right here at Hal Capone's Grand Gatsby speakeasy, to resolve their differences. Will these two underground organizations resolve their disputes? Will there be a massive upset? Will there be rekindling of fatal flames like in the past? We'll see. But now, we'd like to introduce the cast. Each has a few questions for you. Please, audience, yell out your answers to the questions, because we need your help with some 1920s slang. So, listen up, listen carefully, and let's see and figure out just who done it.
Hello. I'm Zeta Zarbo. You know me, the silent film star, along with my co-worker, Harry. But also, I'm Hal's best girl.
She done it.
I have a couple of questions for you. In 1920, what would "it's the berries" mean?
Very good.
Very good.
Terrific. Oh, you're so bright. And if I called you a piker, what would that mean?
Cheapskate.
Oh, see, I knew you'd know.
Good afternoon. I'm Hal Capone. This is my speakeasy, the Grand Gatsby, the best place in Chicago. If you want to have a good time, you come to the Grand Gatsby.
All right.
Anyway, got a couple questions too. If someone called you a blue nose, what would they mean?
Rude.
I like that. And the other one is, other than a flower, in the 20s, what was an orchid?
An expensive item.
You got it.
We didn't hear.
An expensive item.
Hi, everyone. My name is Mona. I'm a dancer, but not any kind of a dancer. Oh, no. This year, I won the National Marathon Dance Contest. My partner and I danced for 87 hours, and we each won $1,000, and that is a lot of moolah. I'm also the girlfriend of the notorious gangster, Beanie O'Dell. But I love someone else. I've got two questions for you. The first one, if I asked you for three
clams,
thank you. If I asked you for three clams, what would you give me?
Money.
Three quarters? Three?
$3,000.
You all knew it. Okay. The second one's a little harder. What is a hay burner?
A horse.
A piece of farm equipment.
Close.
A farmer in the field burning hay.
No.
A farmer standing in the field.
No.
A losing racehorse.
Yes.
Well, hello, everybody. My name is Carol O, and I am the singer here at the Grand Gatsby Speakeasy. Now, some of my fans will call me an angel, and... You're at the wrong place. You belong over at the Two Aces there. They call me an angel. I have large crowds that come to hear me sing. I mean, I'm not bragging. I'm just telling it like it is, right? So, I see some faces out here that I haven't seen at the Grand Gatsby, so I want to just give you a little bit of a feel for the music that we sing over there, that I sing as the main singer. Yes, sir, that's my baby. No, sir, I don't mean maybe. Yes, sir, that's my baby now. I think I'll stop, and I'll try to get it so that you come and see me at the Grand Gatsby tonight. Now, I have a couple questions for you, but you've really been answering them, so you'll probably know these rather easily as well. What was a canary back in the 20s?
Singer.
A snitch? Oh, I haven't heard that one. I heard someone say singer. Yes, I've heard of it as a singer, a great singer.
Oh, the days with a lovely voice.
There we go. You got it. All right, and the second one is, what does it mean to carry a torch?
In the Olympics.
I heard the Olympics, and that's not quite good. You love someone, exactly. Wow, you're a tough crowd. All right, come and see me at the Grand Gatsby.
Hey there, my name is Beanie O'Gannon.
I'm the owner of the Two Aces Speakeasy, and that's a lot classier than this dump. We've got the best music, the best whiskey, and the best cigars in all of Chicago. My organization is known for bootlegging, racketeering, illegal gambling, and running a protection racket. My arch rival over here, Hal Sapone, and I don't agree on much, but one thing we do agree on, we both love money. So therefore, we have decided to merge the North Side Gang with the South Side Gang, and between the two of us, we're going to make a lot of money. I just got one question for you guys. What is a 20s bowl session? Come on, I need some BS.
bunch of guys sitting around.
People complaining about everything.
Nope.
20 what?
Guys talking?
Oh, close. Close.
Exaggerating?
Well, I'll tell you what it is. Dames, guys on a street corner talking about dames. Thank you, Bill.
Yeah, gossip session about dames.
Hi, everybody. Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm Hattie Drinks. I'm a waitress here, you know? A girl's got to do what she's got to do to make a living. So I sell cigarettes. I sell Lucky Strikes, Camels, and Chesterfields. As specialty drinks, today we are doing old-fashioned gin rickeys and sidecars. Woo. They're not bad. All right. Now, in order to get out of this stupid dress that I was told I had to wear, so I can leave this job, I have to get rid of Kara.
Hey.
Oh, so I can become a nighttime singer.
Oh, that's not gonna happen.
Oh. I forgot my questions. Does that surprise you any? Any of those old fashions? Well, the first one is, if I would say you're a bee's knees, what does that mean?
Really good.
Well, close.
Cute.
Anybody else?
Beekeeper?
Knees? Oh, I wish.
Special.
I wish.
How about special?
That's it. That's the right answer. Now, the next question is, if I would say you're a big cheese, and it's not because you're from Wisconsin. Now, we're Illinois people, so what could that be?
Very important.
Limburger?
Well, I guess I'll take that because the answer was big shot. Yeah.
That's me, the big shot.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, nobody pulled anything funny tonight. Call me Tommy Three Guns Beagle. There's not much that I do that's legal. My main boss man is Hal Sapone. You cross him, and you'll buy yourself a tombstone. Now, in the 1920s jargon, what does it mean? What does it mean if I asked you to butt me? What does it mean if I asked you to butt me?
A kick in the rear.
Oh, come on.
Give him a cigarette.
Amen. And finally, what is a juice joint?
Bar.
Bar.
Well, that's good. Yeah. It's a place where liquor is sold. Right. Amen. Thank you.
I'm a temperance leader.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Handsome Sam. And I'm the right-hand man of this guy over here, Beanie O'Donnell. Beanie O'Donnell, what a guy, I'll tell you that. The next thing, all the dames seem to be attracted to me, and I just cannot figure it out.
Neither can we.
So last night I was laying in bed, and I started to think about this. Why do they keep coming to me? And finally, I came to the conclusion. It was because they wanted to kiss my bald head. Now, I have a couple of questions for you here. What were glasses... what were glasses during the 20s called?
Cheaters!
Yeah, that's it! The other question I got for you, what is hooch?
Hoochie coochie.
Moonshine.
That's good.
Bootleg liquor.
You got it back here, Al. But you're not Al. You're my buddy Beanie. Why did I call you Al?
Because you want to upgrade him.
Hi there, y'all. My name is Hershey Barr. I'm a former player with the Chicago White Sox. I hold a couple records there, you know. I hold the record for the most flies caught in right field. Oh, and by the way, I caught a few fly balls while I was out there, too. I don't play baseball anymore. That's a young man's game. But I've now played the saxophone. You can catch my act at the Grand Gatsby, and I'll accompany Kara tonight. I'm also the brother of handsome Sam McWorthy, who we just heard from. He's Beanie O'Dannon's right-hand man. In the 1920s, who can tell me what was called a dead soldier?
Empty bottle.
Empty glass. Empty beer bottle. Yep. And anybody know what the term hard boiled meant?
Tough.
Right again.
Hi everyone, I'm Wyleen Black, and I am a newspaper reporter who likes to blackmail people because I like to spend money. Now, I have two questions for you. The first one is, what does ducky mean in the 20s?
Good.
Fine.
Good.
Good.
Floating.
No.
How about very good?
Yeah. That's it. And the second question is, what are glad rags?
Colorful clothes.
Yep. But
on the town of it.
Okay, that's it. Thank you, everybody.
Hello. My name is Jazzy Fringe.
Oh, Jazzy.
And I'm the lead canary at Beanie's Club.
Ah.
You know, the two aces. I would give anything to be the lead singer here at the Grand Gatsby. Oh.
In your wildest dreams, lady!
Anything. So, it's the Roaring Twenties. I have some questions. What's another name for a drugstore cowboy? Come on, you can do better than that.
A drugstore.
Pharmacy all the time.
No.
That's a man standing on the street corner looking for dames.
You got it. Okay, this one's a lot easier. What's a gin mill?
A bar where liquor sold, you know?
Well, actually, Kira, I'm not surprised you got that one. What's another term for a private investigator?
A gent.
Ooh, they got that one.
Hello, I'm Chuck Limburger. I'm going to be the first to fly solo across the Atlantic, except for my boost. I'm going to be the first to fly solo across the Atlantic. I got a couple questions to read to you if I can find this thing. Oh, here we go. What does don't take any wooden nickels mean?
Don't be duped.
Not close, not close.
Don't be cheating.
Don't be foolish.
Exactly. And what are you supposed to do if you're told to dry up?
Stop drinking. Stop drinking.
Stop tripping on the floor.
Oh, shut up.
There we go.
I love that. Face makeup.
My name is Marlene Markin, and I am the best mime in this building. I have a couple questions too, but first, I want to tell you
that there's going to be a movie made here. It's called The St. Patrick's Massacre. And I would really like to be in it. So I want any of you who happen to know the right people to give them a word about Marley Marvin. First question. I have also always, or often, been referred to as a fire extinguisher. What does that mean?
Hot stuff.
Hot stuff, no. Good idea, though.
The boring person in a party?
I hope not.
To be a chaperone.
Oh. I put out a lot of fires.
Well, that's how that goose looked, thou cream-faced loon.
My second question is, both Beanie and Hal, when they're interviewing new ladies to work in their establishments, look for good gams.
Legs.
Thank you. Oh, my name is Faye Stingray. Some people say I'm peculiar, while others say I'm a very conservative flapper gal. I have been vigorously working on a new novel. And as I sit here and think about it, I'm wondering if you could determine what I'm thinking, but I doubt it, as I lurk in the shadows and soak up the scenes around me. Are you a mobster?
No!
Myers.
Beanie.
Hal.
Yeah, Hal. Sorry about that. Beanie, I'm reasonably pleased with the way our two organizations are getting together. We need to work together more.
Yeah, me too, Hal. I think it's a good thing.
We should put more gaming rooms on the south side, though. We just need to have more gaming rooms. We can't have more on the north.
Yeah, I mean, more tables means more money.
Right.
Sorry, Hal. They got to be with the north side gang.
No, Beanie. We'll have to work this out later. But I want more in the south.
We'll see. Good luck, Hal.
Hal, I'm so glad to be with you. It makes me feel invincible. Safe.
Good, kitten. But if I ever catch you smooching with that TV or that movie guy again, it's all over for you.
I'm glad I ended my relationship with Carol O. I'm in love with you, sweetie.
I'm so glad to hear you say that, Sam. I never liked Kara, and I don't think she's a good singer either.
But what about Beanie? If he finds out about us, he could have us both bumped off.
I'm happy being Beanie's right-hand man and would never, never think of leaving him, his gang. But I'm going to do everything I can to get you away from him, Mona. Even if it means bumping him off and becoming the new crime boss of the north side of Chicago.
You know, Mona, I hate Patty Lowe. Or Carol Lowe. Dang, these names are getting worse. I really want to get rid of her, but I'm kind of worried because there might be other dames in line for that job.
Well, just tell Beanie that you'll consider his offer to be a waitress at his place, the Two Aces, and then tell him that you're glad that he appreciates good talent. And this way, you work yourself up to the top position there.
I think that's good advice. So
So, Hal, where are you, Hal? You better be listening to me and giving me the job that Kira has so I can become the lounge singer, because otherwise I'm going to Beanie O'Dana's, two basses, to become a singer.
Hattie, 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 you wish you could sing as good as I do. You sound more like a turkey than a canary when you sing. Gobble, gobble, gobble. You don't have a chance at becoming a lounge singer for Hal Sapone. Not a chance.
You just wait.
Al, don't you worry. I'll be watching your back all night.
Thank you, Tommy. I heard a rumor that Beanie's men are planning an ambush on the South Side gangsters the second the new relationship falls off. But I don't see it falling off. Do you, Beanie?
Beanie, what's this I hear about an ambush?
Tommy, not true. Don't believe every rumor that comes your way.
That's good. Just keep your men under control, Beanie, if that's at all possible, or my guys will take them for a ride.
No, not the ride.
Yeah, the ride.
Oh, Hal, I have something to say. Hey, Mona, I want you to know that I was thinking about telling Beanie about your little affair there with Sam. And the only reason I haven't done it is that I figure Beanie's gonna kill Sam. And I really care about him.
Kara, no matter what you or anyone else says, I'm still with Beanie and no one else.
Well, you know what? You don't have any true friends because your best friend, Hattie, is betraying you. And I'm not even going to say why, but just be warned.
Does anyone here believe that Hattie's acting like she's hiding something? No, I didn't think so.
Sam.
What?
You're blackmailing me with those pictures that you have of me and Harry on the set of our last film, Smooching. You've got to stop the blackmailing.
No way, Zeta. No way. I'll continue paying or Hal is going to find out about your frequent smooching after filming sessions. By the way, don't try to blackmail me. I've ended my relationship with Hattie. You understand? She is irritating and can't sing as near as well as Kara.
Hey, Sam, I'll be watching your back all night, so don't be a dumb Dora and do anything stupid. I heard you are messing with a lot of dames, including Zeta, and you better know that she's the dame of a crime boss. If you don't know that, you're dumber than you look.
I can't help being attracted to women. If any attached dames think I might have feelings for them, I'd break off the relationship immediately. By the way, I've seen you over at the other side of town. You're secretly with my boss, Beanie, and I don't like it.
If she wears a skirt, you'll love her.
Say, Beanie, you know I always worry about my brother Sam getting hurt. See what happened with the incident with the cops a couple weeks ago? Look at his knee. Or worse yet, he could be killed because of his gangster life. Beanie, would you allow Sam to leave the gang?
Hershey, you gotta understand one thing. Once a gangster, always a gangster until you die. There's no getting out of the mob.
Well then, Hal, just remember that I asked you to get my brother Sam away from Beanie. I don't like what Beanie's influence has done to Sam, and I worry his life is in danger.
since he's now seeing Mona, who happens to be Beanie's dame.
I don't know, Hershey. I don't know. We'll just have to wait and see.
Patty, what?
You never pay attention to me.
Well, are you worth paying attention to?
Well, I'm telling you, I'm gonna blackmail, and I'm gonna talk about you, and if you don't pay me any money, that's it.
Well, guess what? The joke's on you. Because Sam and I have broken it off. So you can't have to worry about trying to blackmail me.
Okay, then, set up. I'd like to talk to you next. I'm understanding that you are dating the mob boss, Al. Okay, so I'll drop the blackmail against you now, but the moment you break up, I am going to publish the pictures of you looking frazzled with no makeup on.
You're all hard. You witch. Hal, I think you're the cat's meow. And I'd love to be your dame.
Sorry, Jazzy. Me and Zeta are a pair.
I don't believe she loves you. Send her back to those fancy Hollywood types. And leave this handsome gangster to a ritzy mall like me.
Boy.
I'm not the first non-stop transatlantic flight. I love alcohol. I always drink a bunch of it before I fly. It makes me feel lighter.
Here's payback again. I'm writing a novel about the rival mobster gangs in Chicago. And that's why I keep my eyes on these two bosses, wherever he is, over there, and all their right-hand men. But my real reason for writing this novel is because I want to get close to Beanie. I have fallen in love with his ruthless bad boy image from the newspapers.
Beanie, there's a rumor out that you've got a hit out on Hal.
Zeta, I don't have a hit on Hal yet.
Sam, I know you're having an affair with Mona. You better be careful and not let Beanie know until I tell you to let him know. If you double-cross me and tell Beanie before I'm ready, I'll see to it that my right-hand man, Tommy here, bumps you off.
Really?
Yeah.
I'll tell Beanie whatever I want, Hal. You'll be taking orders from me very soon. You got that? After I take over the North Gang. Zeta, is there anything I should know about Mona that I would find interesting?
You might find it interesting to investigate her relationship with Sam.
My right-hand man? Zeta, are you considering a relationship with your silent co-film star, Harry?
No.
Because if you are, I will protect Harry for a lifetime, unless you leave Hal.
Zeta, I would prefer
that you don't mess with this film star, Harry. I got a sixth sense about him. I think he's half crooked. Tell you, producers, to pick someone on the funny side, like Mari.
Okay.
Hey, everybody, I just found out. I am going to be moving my show over to the Two Aces over by Beanie.
Yes!
Oh, God. You know, the only reason that the Grand Gatsby here is so busy is because of me. And so when I go move over there, they're all going to be following me over. It'll become the hoppin' joint.
That's great news, Kara. Hey, Hattie, would you accept a job as a waitress at the Two Aces?
Well, that makes two of us. I'm taking Beanie up on his offer, and soon I'll be in the spotlight. Sing like a canary.
Canary, don't you mean turkey, remember? You know what, Hattie?
What?
Don't get your hopes up too high, because I'm going to be over there before you are. So you're going to be have to be listening to my beautiful voice every shift. Oh. Lucky you.
Sorry, Mona.
Sam, I have a question. Because I'm really worried.
Don't be worried.
Microphone.
Well, have you broken everything off with Kara? Because I don't dare break it off with Beanie yet until I know that you're 100% committed to be my guy. Someone should bump off Beanie.
No. Don't worry, Mona. If Beanie finds out about us, I'll have to bump him off and take over as the mob boss.
No way.
Mona, you look worried. I'm your friend. Don't worry, I won't let anyone say anything bad about you.
Oh, thanks, Jazzy. I am worried that Sam and my affair, people are finding out and talking about it, and they're the wrong people. I'm afraid someone's going to get hurt.
We know nobody keeps a secret.
Mona, I'm your brother and I worry about you. Find someone nice like the film stars, Harry or Marley. Leave the gangsters alone once and for all.
Oh, Chuck, I can't do that. Those guys are boring.
Hey, Beanie. You know, now that I'm a part of your group and I'm moving over to the Two Aces there, I feel that I need to be level with you and let you know about something that I heard, all right? I heard that your right-hand man, Sam, and your gal, Mona, are having an affair.
Rip, Kara, I don't know if I can trust you, but I'll tell you what. If a dame double-crosses me, I'd have to bump them both off.
Tommy, I'm going to give you only 15 days now to pay me off for that blackmail, or I'm going to tell Hal that you are the brother of Beanie.
Hey, Beanie, I need some help. Waylon, the newspaper person, is blackmailing me. And she's going to tell that I'm spying on this other mob for you. I need the dough to pay her off.
Look at Tommy, I can lend you the money, but you gotta keep spying for me.
No problem.
Sam, I've decided to tell Hal about what happened between me and Harry on the set. I can't afford your blackmail any longer. So I've decided I'm going to tell him. And it's just, There's nothing else I can do.
I'll never stop my blackmailing. You understand that? But I'll give you another couple of months to come up with the dough, the cash. And you better get it to me.
Sam, I know your blackmailing set up. I have a duty to tell Hal that his dame is cheating on him. Of course, if you'll cut me in on a percentage of the blackmail, I'll reconsider.
No way.
Beanie, I would do anything, I mean anything, to be your dame. That's the only reason I'm writing this novel about the Chicago rival gangs, is just to get close to you.
Hey!
Oh, no!
Oh, my gosh!
Oh my God, he's dead!
Did somebody shoot him?
No, he's been stabbed. Can't you see the blood?
Oh yeah, he must have been stabbed.
I was standing right next to Tommy when the lights went off and came back on. He must have done it for Hal.
I done it.
I realized my right-hand man was standing next to Sam's body when the lights went on. But I didn't give the order. Not this time.
Someone killed my Sam. I wasn't near him. I was way over there somewhere.
Oh, well, I wasn't too far from him, but there were a lot of other people that were closer than I was.
Look, I was a long ways from the light switch. It would have been impossible for me to turn the lights off, come back through the dark, get over to Sam before the lights came back on again. Therefore, I didn't do it.
My Sam! I can't believe it! He was murdered! Who could it be? It had to be someone that was close by. But it had to be someone who had the most to gain. And the biggest motive. It had to be the one who was the killer.
I just walked over where the screams were coming from. I didn't do it.
I'm glad we've got these front seats.
Oh, I'm gnarly. Sorry.
Sam.
I was having a great time at the speakeasy. And then the next thing I recall is the lights went out and my ghostly essence floated over the other guests.
You should consider the time it would take for each suspect in the room to walk over to Sam, who was closest, who was fastest.
The murderer is most likely the one who turned off the lights.
I don't believe a mob boss would get his hands dirty.
I saw Carol turn the lights on.
I was so drunk I don't remember anything.
Okay, folks. We got a murder. Now we got to figure out who done it. So who do you think did this? Who wanted Sam dead? Was it a mob boss? Was it jealousy? Was it money? Was it envy?
What was it? So give me some accusations. Who do you think done this to this poor man, Sam?
It was her. She said she'd do it.
The butler.
In the library.
In the library. Okay, how about another wild guess?
The same red girl.
The mime.
The mime? Why do you think the mime did it?
Why not? She's quiet.
Okay, speaking. Richard, what do you think?
The mime.
You think the mime? How many people think the mime did it? Raise your hand. Really? Oh. How about another guess? Was it a man? Was it a woman?
Woman.
You think it was who? You think it was the waitress? Oh, why do you think the waitress spotted it? Who thinks it was the waitress? Raise your hand.
Yeah,
a few more, okay. Maybe you might be getting warm. I don't know. What do you think? What else?
John Hobbs.
Oh, the bouncer in the back. The bouncer in the back. The guy snuck in, right, huh?
I still say Zeta.
You think it was Zeta? Why do you think it was Zeta?
She was too close, and she's really good.
She's really good. She is very good. I agree with that one. Well,
I think it was Richard.
You think it was Richard? Okay. Well, listen, you got some good guesses out there, but now let's really see who done it.
Hi, I'm Sal Capone. I was nowhere near Sam when he was bumped off. I couldn't have murdered him. And I obviously would have never commit my own murders. I got guys for that anyway. I didn't trust any of the Beanie's men, so it couldn't have been them. But I can't say I called this one myself. I did know that he was messing around with Mona, and things like that will get you swimming with the fishes. Isn't that right, Beanie?
Could be. Look, and I'm Beanie O'Dannon, and obviously I would not pull a hit on myself. But a big attaboy for whoever did this, because as Hal said, this wise guy was messing around with my dame, Mona. And by the way, Mona, I know everything that's going on with you, and I don't want anything to do with your no-good keister from this point on. You're lucky I don't call a favor in from a torpedo and have you bumped off.
Hi, Hattie.
Hattie, just a second.
Oh, I'm too fast?
No, I think you're right on.
Oh, some people say I'm kind of slow, too. Okay.
Go ahead.
Hi, Hattie. I actually had a love affair with Sam. I'm sorry, Mona, but he was a cat's pajamas. I just couldn't resist the guy. But then one day, he broke it off with me. And man, I was upset. I was going to run down to Beanie's place and have Sam have a hit put on him. But then I thought, you know, well, if I couldn't have Sam, nobody's going to get Sam. And then I thought, you know, if I took the job down at Beanie's joint, I'd be spending more time with Sam. And I'm up for a challenge. That way, I could maybe get my Sam back. So no, I wasn't the murderer.
Tommy here. I think some of you already know, but I happen to be the brother of Beanie. My name is actually Tommy O'Gannon. I just like beagle dogs. That's why I picked the name Beagle. You know, with their flappy ears and all, they're so damn cute. But actually, I'm part of the Southside mob, but I'm only here to spy on Hal and the Northside. I would not have murdered Sam since I didn't want to give up my identity or my position in the mob. Just think, if I could have bumped off Hal, just think, then I could have taken control of the South Side and joined with my brother in the North. We'd control all of Chicago, once and for all. Did I want Sam dead? Sure as hell I did. Beanie told me that no good dried-up double-crosser was necking with his dame Mona. I would have loved to bump him off for Beanie. That's the God's honest truth. But a knife in the back? That's not my style. I didn't do it.
I obviously could not have committed suicide, as it would have been impossible to stab myself in the back. So go and dry up. If you even considered it a suicide, I plan on haunting you all forever. I hope you are ready for it. I leave you more. I love you.
Mona here. Yes, I was having an affair with Sam. That's the truth. We were so much in love, and we couldn't hide it. And so the wrong people found out. And of course, we couldn't tell Beanie. He would never understand. And I think he's going to have his revenge out on me. So I'm going to have to leave Chicago. I heard about this small town in Wisconsin. It's called Dousman. I think I'll go there. Now, you know I would never kill a man I love. So, you know I'm not guilty.
I can't believe that any of you think that I, Hershey Barr, could be a suspect in my own brother's murder. I don't have the slightest motive. I knew that this kind of lifestyle would lead to this, and that is why I pleaded with him daily to get out. I blame you, Beanie, for the murder of my brother Sam. Even if you didn't hold the knife yourself, you were the cause of this. So Beanie, give me Sam's old job of being your right-hand man. I think I want to be a gangster now.
Hershey, I think that would be a good position for you, but remember what I told you earlier. Once a gangster, always a gangster until you die. There's no getting out of the mob.
Yeah.
Welcome to the North Side Gang.
Yeah, I do. Thank you.
Hi. Remember me?
Yes. You're the one.
Jazzy. Yeah.
Look. I didn't really even know Sam. Once in a while, I'd see him around, sometimes at the speakeasy. But I didn't have a reason or a motive to kill him. Frankly, I don't have a motive to kill anybody. I would, however, like to take this opportunity to tell everyone how much I love Hal. And when I'm the lead singer at the Grand Gatsby, well, I'll have so much more time to spend with Hal. Mm-hmm.
Of course, I didn't murder Sam. He was going to tell me all of the pictures of Zeta and the co-star with Harry smooching, so that I could take over all the blackmails. Now, I would never murder someone who I was going to blackmail. That doesn't make sense.
I did see what a snake Sam was. He was messing around with my sister Mona, and he had Hera at Hattie and Kira on the side. The snake got what he deserved. And I didn't do it.
Oh.
Mona, and I don't have any possible motive. I hardly even knew Sam. But if any of you happen to know who's going to be in charge of the movie that they're going to make here, you know, Midnight Massacre at the at St. Patrick's Day, please put a word in so that I get the job. Well, Sam was actually doing me a favor by getting rid of that no good Mona and taking her away from my bean. So I'm very irritated with the person that bumped him off. Obviously, I'm not the murderer. I have been writing this novel about the Chicago mobster gangs just to get close to Beanie. I'm not interested in any of you, just Beanie. Woo!
I was by the switch, the light switch, when the lights went out. It's true. But they went out. I felt around for the switch, and I turned the lights back on. And I have to tell you, I was mortified to see Sam hunched over in the chair. I mean, there he was, this guy who so thoughtlessly jilted me, laying there dead. But you know what? I was still in shock from him jilting me, letting me go, saying he didn't love me anymore. But you know what? I did not kill him. I was not the murderer. What I did do, however, is I told Beanie that Sam and Mona were having the affair. I mean, now that I'm part of his group, his gang, I need to be on the up and up and let him know things like that. But you know, everybody knows you don't double cross a mob boss.
Okay. I stabbed him. He had those pictures of me and Harry on the film set and smooching. I know Harry carries a torch for me. But I don't care about him. It was just kind of a spur of the moment thing. We're not lovers. It was more a celebration of the end of the film kind of thing. I just had gotten together with Hal. Where are you, Hal? Oh, a week before. So it didn't mean anything. But Sam wouldn't stop blackmailing me. He wanted big clams for those pictures, and I didn't have any more money. So, what was I to do? What is a dame to do? Hal, I love you. I really do. You're the bee's knees, the big cheese, my ducky daddy-o, and I want to be with you forever. But Sam wouldn't quit. So I grabbed the shiv out of my garter and I stabbed him. Oh. I didn't have a choice. No need to call in the private dicks. Just call the police and tell them to come and get, or somebody on the north side. Just bump me off. But first,